At this point in Mark's narrative of the gospel, Jesus has chosen 12 disciples, and he's in the process of training them for ministry, training them to go out into the world and to share, after he rises from the dead, the gospel. They've seen some incredible things. Jesus has healed many people, the paralytic, the man with the withered hand. He also has control over nature. He's able to tell the storm, be muzzled, and the storm immediately comes to a halt. And the disciples say, what manner of man is this? What kind of person are we dealing with? Then he can even raise the dead. He takes Jairus' daughter and he raises her from the dead. Along the way, Jesus is teaching them the mystery of the kingdom of God. He's starting to speak in parables. And it's been given to these guys, these 12 disciples, these no-name guys, it's been given to them to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. They're going to be in charge of establishing this mystery, the ecclesia, the church of God, that Jesus would die on the cross and call all tribes, nations, kindred, and tongue. Anybody who wants to be saved can join the family of God through Jesus Christ. That's a mystery that was hidden in ages past. And God is delivering this to these disciples through Jesus in his ministry. And he's training them because they're the ones that are going to deliver that message to the world, to proclaim it to every tribe and take it to the ends of the earth. The disciples at this point, they want Jesus to set up this earthly kingdom. It will happen at the end of this age when Jesus is done calling out his bride. But at this point, they want that to happen right away. So their concept of the Messiah is going to be tested, especially when Jesus goes to the cross. Jesus is preparing them for that eventuality. They believe Jesus is Messiah, but they're still trying to wrap their minds around the fact that Jesus is God. Now, you have to remember, Jesus didn't glow. He walked on water. He did amazing things. He told the nature to shut up. He did all these things. He did many miracles. But even John the Baptist said, I wouldn't have known who he was unless the Spirit descended on him like a dove. And that is one that God told me that would be the Messiah. So he wouldn't even have recognized Jesus unless God identified Jesus for him. So Jesus didn't glow. He wasn't remarkable in any way that we would see. And he was identified by the Spirit. So he looked like an ordinary man. And these men, these women that hung out with Jesus, they sat with him. They talked with Jesus. They handled Jesus. They listened to Jesus. They were able to sit around a fire with Jesus. They were able to hug Jesus, all these things. So it was hard for even them to grasp the fact that they were looking at God, at the Creator. This is a hard concept for them. They're not going to fully understand it until Jesus rises out from among the dead. All they have now is these amazing miracles, his gracious teaching. Philip would say in John 14, it would get to the point where Philip says to Jesus, look, just show us God. You've been talking about you don't go anywhere, do anything, say anything unless the Father tells you to. Just show us the Father and we'll be happy. We'll be happy. And Jesus looks at Philip and says, Philip, have I been with you so long? 3 years I've been hanging out with you. And you say, show me the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen God. I and my Father are one. I don't go do say anything unless he tells me to go do or say it. Then he says, look, believe me. He says, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or just believe me for the works that I'm doing in front of you. Just believe it for the work's sake is what he says. In chapter 6, as we go into chapter 6, Jesus starts to deal with unbelief, refusing to believe in Jesus. He's telling them, look, Philip, believe me or believe the works that I'm doing. But you have to do one thing. You got to believe. It's important. There's going to be people that unbelieve in this chapter, chapter 6. Hebrews tells us not to have an evil heart of unbelief and to turn away from the faith. So we're going to see unbelief in Jesus' hometown, a group of people that should have believed in him because they knew him. They watched him live for 30 years. We're going to see unbelief in Herod and his enemies. And we're going to see even unbelief at the end in the disciples. Chapter 6 starts out like this. And he went out from thence and came into his own country, and his disciples followed him. So he goes back to Nazareth. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. So Jesus returns to Nazareth, and he goes back to the same synagogue that he was at a year earlier. Now, first time he preached there, they tried to throw him off a cliff a year earlier. Now, I don't know about you. If people run me out of their church with a gun, I'm not coming back any year later. I'm probably not coming back ever. You know, it's going to take me a whole lot of begging to get me to come back and an armed guard to walk in there and make sure I'm safe. they try to kill Jesus in Nazareth at this same synagogue. So that just shows you how gracious Jesus is. He's willing to go back and give them another opportunity to hear his word, give them another opportunity to believe, give them another opportunity to say, yes, you're just not a carpenter, you're the savior of the world, you're the creator. He gives them that opportunity because he loves them. He grew up with them. The first time he was there, he opened the scroll to Isaiah, and he said this. He read Isaiah 61. He said, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. So his first message wasn't hellfire and brimstone. It was good tidings, right? You'd think they wouldn't have thrown him off a cliff for that one. Preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. I'm liking this message. To proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of prison to them that are bound. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And it's to say they didn't accept him or the year of the Lord would be an understatement. They tried to kill him. But instead of writing off his hometown, he goes back. Now remember, Jesus has probably worked for many of these people. He's made yokes, oxen. He's made things in their house. He's not just a worker with wood. He works with stone. They had more stone than he did wood back then. So he built it all. He built some of their homes. He sat in their living rooms, as it were. He built things for them. And he always did a perfect job. He always treated everybody in town with love and respect. He got about 10,000 to 15,000 people living in this town. And Jesus did. Nobody has a bad word to say about Jesus. He always did the right job, always charged the right amount, probably did everything perfect. He's God, right? Who do you want doing your carpentry job? Working on your home? God. And he did that. So they have no reason not to believe him. No one in town can say anything bad about him. And they began to teach in their synagogue, and many hearing him, they were astonished. And they say, from whence hath this man, this derogatory, these things? Where did he get this knowledge? What wisdom is this which is given unto him? How did he get all this wisdom in the word? That even such mighty works, look at the works that he's doing, are wrought by his hands. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary? Now, in that day, they would always say the son of Joseph or the son of the man, but here they say the son of Mary, intimating that he's illegitimate. The brother of James, so he's got brothers and Josie and Judah and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended at him, or literally they were repelled. They're astonished at his words of wisdom and his mighty works. What happened to Jesus? He left here, he left town, a carpenter, and now he's back. He's a big shot rabbi, and he's got a whole bunch of disciples. Is not this the carpenter? That's a derogatory statement because they're saying, he's not a rabbi. You're listening to somebody who's never been trained. We know who he is. He's just a carpenter. He's just an average Joe. We've seen him in town. He's nobody special. It's their way of pointing out that Jesus didn't go to their schools or didn't train under any rabbis. We know Jesus. We've seen his work, and he ain't no rabbi. Justin Martyr said that Jesus made plows and he made yokes for oxen. And many of these people had Jesus out to their farm to say, hey, you know, can you make a yoke for my oxen? And Jesus, you know, God chose to be any profession. He chose to be a builder. You know, so he would go out to their place and he would look at oxen and he would make a yoke for them that was perfectly fitted for those beasts or those animals. Jesus is a builder. He knows how to build in our lives. And it's no wonder that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, 28, he says this to us, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. How many oxen had he seen when he said this? He knew exactly what he was talking about. And I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus knows how to fit a yoke upon every one of us. He's always done a good job for these people. Where did he get this wisdom? Where did he get this word? We know that he's a carpenter. He's the son of Mary, which was a terrible insult. Mary's illegitimate son, and quite possibly Joseph had died at this time. And he had stayed till he was 30 years old at the home, all these kids in the home, and he supported the home until they were old enough to get their own jobs and take over. So he stayed at home till he was 30 years old, and they say, we know his brother, we know his sisters. Even they don't believe in him at this point yet. So they're offended and repelled by him, this man. And that's what the Pharisees would say. We don't want this man to rule over us. You got to understand something about the scripture. If Jesus is just a man to you, he can't do many mighty works in your life. But if Jesus is God, he can do any work in your life. And they had an evil heart of unbelief, although they knew him. They didn't know him at all. They watched him grow up. They didn't know anything about Jesus. They just thought he was a great carpenter, that he always did a fair job. But they didn't know that he wanted to put a yoke on them, that his burden was easy and it was light. And then he's more than just a carpenter that was at their house. He's their savior. He's their Lord. They know him after the flesh, so they're prejudiced and they're ignorant towards Jesus. Because imagine, they had God Almighty living in their town for 30 years. And they didn't even know it. They had no idea that he was there. So here's a great truth. True spirituality doesn't blow the trumpet. It doesn't put on fancy clothes. It doesn't go to a college to become spiritual. You don't go to a seminary to spit out spiritual men. You have to be with Jesus to be spiritual. You have to know the Lord to be spiritual. It doesn't look for a title. True spirituality works quietly, and it lets God lift you up. It doesn't seek its own. So we have the wrong idea, I think, of what spirituality looks like. You know, I go to all these pastors, they fight over the size of their churches or the amount of money that comes in, and I don't think Jesus cares one whit about all that. I think he cares about souls being saved and people being transformed and the power that he can display in a church that's committed to his lordship and his being the only way to the Father. We have the wrong idea, I think, of what it looks like. We see the exact opposite of what Jesus was from some pastors today. Now, Jesus had brothers and sisters, too, so there's no such thing as the perpetual virginity of Mary. Mary was a virgin. Jesus' father was God, but every one of the other kids had Joseph as their father. So he had more siblings after the fact that he was born. So nothing special about Jesus. He's a nobody. We know his family. We know his job. We know his occupation. We know who he is. We watched him grow up from a little kid. They walked by sight and not by faith. They were blind as to who they had in their town. A similar thing was said about the disciples of Jesus in Acts. It said this, and I always take comfort in this because you know what? I get it too. I wasn't trained at, I go back to Philly and it's very difficult for me to go back to some old friends because they remember me after my crazy days. They don't know me according to what Christ has done in my life. I haven't been to schools, you know, I get it. When we moved here, I got calls from pastors that, you know, wanted me to move out. I don't know why. You guys are great people, so I'm not going to tell you this so you go hurt them or anything. But anyway, sometimes, you know, they look at you as ignorant and unlearned. And you know what? You are until you meet Jesus. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. That should be our testimony as well. Look, what you need to do if you really want to be spiritual is get with Jesus. You don't have to join a church. You don't have to become a seminary. You don't have to wear a collar. What you really need to do is get with Jesus and get in his word. Let him transform and change you. Let him be your savior, but more importantly, let him be your Lord, the Lord of your life, and you will see changes in your life. I'll give you an example. I was down in North Carolina. My uncle lives way back, and he built his own sawmill. He lives in the woods, right? And I sat with him for 4 hours, you know, he took a break, I guess, 70-something years old. And the man knew the Bible backwards and forwards. I could stumble. In fact, he stumped me on a couple things. And I was like, this isn't fair. I'm the pastor. How do you know more than me? He knew the Old Testament, just incredible knowledge. I went into his house. He has this whole room filled with books, and he sits and he reads. He gets up at 3 a.m. every morning, goes to bed at like 7. I guess that goes to show you can learn a lot if you get up early. Where did he get all this knowledge? He just, you know what? Jesus has people like that all over the world. All over the world. And you can be like that too. Nothing's stopping you. The Bible says we've been born again by the Spirit of God. We're all able ministers of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's nothing stopping you from meeting Jesus anywhere. You don't have to come here to meet him. You can meet him in your car. You can meet him at home. You can get in your bedroom, get on your knees, and he will talk to you. He will open up the scriptures to you. You things will be spiritually discerned that were otherwise you would be ignorant of. So you're not ignorant and unlearned. In fact, you're the smartest person in the room if you know Jesus, and you don't have to wear a collar to get it either. So verse 4, but Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, his own kind, his relatives, and in his own house. And he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hand upon a few sick folk, and he healed them. So Jesus understands fully well, you get no respect from your own people. It must have hurt Jesus to get rejected to the people that he treated really good for 30 years by his own friends and neighbors. He was welcome in their home as a carpenter, but don't be talking the Savior stuff. A lot of people know Jesus after just an idea in the Bible, but they don't know Jesus. They'll listen to some of what he's got to say, but they don't want him to be their Lord or their Savior. They know him after their own fleshly perspective of his claims, not from the heavenly view that we've been given since we've been born again. So he was willing to be rejected by them again, and their rejection limited his mighty work in their lives. So he healed a few folks, but their unbelief kept them from receiving all that Jesus had for them. Now the Bible says this. People say, well, what work can we do? Jesus gave us one work to do. Now we're not saved by works. We're saved by grace through faith, and it's a gift of God, not of works, okay? There is one work that will be evident, and that's a repentant heart. And I think a lot of times we don't have that in the church. So if you don't have a repentant heart, if you don't know you're a sinner, then quite possibly you're not saved. But if you look at it, John 6 says this. Jesus said this. They asked Jesus, what must we do? 6:28. What shall we do that we might work the works of God? We want to do something. Jesus answered, okay, this is the work of God, the one work of God that we can do as human beings. You believe or rely on or trust in him who he has sent. So Jesus doesn't work with unbelief. Non-believers, he can chip away at, he can draw them by the power of his spirit. But somebody who's heard the message and rejected it, that's called unbelief. So if you sat through message after message and you've never given your heart to Christ, you are an unbeliever. You've heard the message and you don't want to believe. That's an unbeliever. He can't do many mighty works in your life in that state. It's possible to grow up with God right in your hometown, to hire him to fix a yoke for your oxen, to be a fellow Nazarene and yet never see him do any mighty works in your life because of unbelief is what he's saying. You can grow up with him and never have. You can sit in church constantly, week after week after week, and never see any mighty works because of your unbelief. You really don't trust God. You really don't trust the things that Jesus says. And your life proves it. Amen. So belief is the door through which faith enters. Faith is the substance, evidence of things hoped for. Faith is, give me a break here. Faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's the evidence of things not seen, the substance of things hoped for, I guess, but I flipped it. Belief is the door through which Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart, right? He's saying, let me in. Let me in. I will come in. I will change you. Knock, knock, knock. Yeah. Knocking. Belief is what makes you get out of the chair, open the door, and believe he can change your life. Yeah. That's all it does. It says this in Hebrews 11:6. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God, you must believe first that he exists, that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So belief opens the door, and unbelief keeps Jesus out. Verse 6, it says this, he marveled, Jesus marveled, because of their unbelief, and he went round about the villages teaching. He's amazed at their unbelief. He marveled. Now, his hometown's inability to recognize him made him marvel. There are only two times in the Bible where Jesus marvels. The word there means stand amazed, or literally God says, wow. It's hard to get God to say wow about anything because he made the heavens and the earth. That's a wow, right? Look at it. Look at the stars. We say wow. In fact, all the people that followed Jesus were always standing there marveling. The word is used about the crowds all the time. They marveled at all the works that he did. But Jesus rarely marvels. And the two times that he marvels or where he says, wow, is when it comes to belief and when it comes to faith. belief. He says about the centurion who says he had every reason to believe that this Jewish rabbi wouldn't help his servant. But he believed anyway. And he said, I'm not even worried. You just say the word, Jesus, and my servant will be healed. And Jesus said, wow, I got to go with every Jew to their house and raise him from the dead. But I haven't seen faith like this in all of Israel. And he marveled at the centurion's faith. He said, I'm a man under authority like you're a man under authority. I tell one go, he goes. I tell another go. I can recognize you, Jesus. Your knee is bowed to another throne, another worldly throne. And all you have to do is say the word, and my servant will be healed. And Jesus healed from a distance because that man touched with faith. An amazing, remarkable time that Jesus marvels. The other time he marvels is right here. He marvels at the unbelief of his hometown. So Jesus marvels when he sees someone in the midst of real bad tragedy, somebody who shouldn't trust in him and yet trusts in him anyway. And Jesus says, wow, to your life. Jesus says, wow, to somebody who says, you know what, I don't want the comfort of this or that. I'd rather work for the kingdom of God. Jesus says, wow, that's somebody I'm marveling at that faith. Conversely, the people that knew Jesus and should have had faith or should have had belief was his own hometown people. They knew him. They had every reason to believe in Jesus, and yet they didn't. They refused. And I look at people that grow up in godly homes. They're prayed over every night. They go to churches where the word of God is preached. I mean, down in Philly, you know, my pastor went through the word of God verse by verse, and you don't really know what you have. You don't really know that the blessing that you have. And people come to these churches that preach the word of God. There's very few left that teach the Bible. And they walk away and they never commit their life to Christ. And I think God says, wow about that too. How many people come here week after week? You hear the word, you got opportunity to be saved. And if you never commit to Jesus Christ, that's a wow. You're out of your mind. So Jesus is amazed. So familiarity with Jesus, having him around you, can breed in spectacular unbelief. So the centurion's a ray of hope, and Nazareth is a warning to us all. And I think when Jesus looks at the church in America, what does he see? What does he see? A spectacular unbelief or faith? Do we believe that Jesus Christ can turn the Poconos upside down and people can get saved? Do we believe the heroin epidemic up here can be turned around and Jesus Christ can set them free? Can he do it? I pray he does if the church would get back to teaching his word and believing it themselves. Or how about the people in the church would live such a life that people would know when they come here they're going to get delivered? I wonder what makes him marvel most, and I wonder what makes him marvel in my life. I pray it's centurion belief and not being around them so much that I don't know him at all. Verse 7, and he called unto him the 12 and began to send them forth two by two and gave them power over unclean spirits. So you got to understand, make no mistake, Jesus came to destroy the works of who? The devil. That's his whole plan here. As the Father has sent me, the Bible says, so send I you, Jesus would say. He would say, the councils are the gates of hell upon this rock, that I'm the Son of the living God. I'm going to build my ecclesia, and the councils of hell, the gates of hell, will not prevail against my church. So it's a battle. The church is not a country club, people. It's a war machine. We're not here to find out, you know, how comfortable we can make it on the Titanic. We're here to show people the lifeboat, to get them to Jesus so they can get off of this crazy planet that's doomed for destruction and have a home in heaven with Jesus. And he's going to come back and rule this earth for 1,000 years and create a new heaven and a new earth. That's what we're living for. That's our hope. So we're in a battle. We're in a war because the current people that run this world are ruled by the principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world. So our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and rulers that move these pieces around the earth. And our job as Christians is to be salt and light and win them to Jesus before it's too late. So we're in a battle. We're not about looking for comfort. We're looking to fight. We're looking to bring the kingdom. We're looking to be missionaries, if you will, teachers, preachers of the word. Eternity is on the line. Souls are on the line. So Jesus chose his disciples and he sends them out with buddies. So it's important, you know, people look at that, you know, look, a pastor is only one man. You got to have a buddy. I need a buddy. you know? Anybody want to be my buddy, let me know afterward. You got to have somebody in a foxhole with you when you're getting beat up. You look, you still love me, right? Yeah, they love you. It's usually your wife, and then the poor girl gets beat up so much she's sick now. Pray for her. She's at home. So I don't have a buddy. No, I'm just kidding. I got all you. You are my buddies. It's important to have at least one person united with you in the battle. You need that. So Jesus gave them, the word here says he gave them power over unclean spirits, his exousia, is his royal permission, liberty. He gave them the royal right while he's there to heal at will, to cast out demons at will, to be his representatives. They're warriors of the king, so he sends them out, and they're able to put down the powers of darkness because he gave them that exousia, that royal right to set people free. Now, the Bible says the church receives dunamis. Are all workers of dunamis, it says in Corinthians. And Paul says the implication is no. Not everybody has dunamis or power to, but we've all been filled by the Spirit of God and we've been empowered to do the ministry that God has for each one of us. And we all have a ministry. So we look for power from on high when we're filled with the Holy Ghost to be representatives of Jesus in this earth. Some are pastors, some are teachers. Everybody has gifts that we're supposed to operate in, helps, edification, prophecy. All the gifts of the Spirit are available, I believe, for each one of us. Here they get special power and authority in Jesus' name, and I believe we'll have the same in the millennium when Jesus comes and rules and reigns. So they receive something special. They can do as they please because Jesus gave them that right to heal at will and to cast out demons at will. So incredible power transferred, but remember, that power did not save them eternally. Judas had the same power, okay? Judas raised people from the dead, and he did miracles too. Did he go to heaven? Oh, people are, but the son of perdition, Jesus calls him. He's chosen him, and I chose you 12, and one of you is a devil, he would say. Interesting, too, the Antichrist will come with all power, signs, and lying wonders. Power, signs, and wonders are not necessarily a proof that somebody is operating in the Spirit of God. Okay? Satan can do miracles, too. All right? He whooped up the storm, and Jesus shut it up. So you have to realize, as we look at this, our world is in a major titanic battle. There's another Christ coming with all power, signs, and lying wonders, but he's going to come with another gospel, another message, and people will believe him because they didn't love the truth to be saved. They will believe the lie, and God himself will send them a strong delusion that's going to be accompanied by powerful signs and wonders and miracles, and people are going to be led astray by them. So just because there's miracles does not mean it's from God. Amen. I want you to realize that. The only thing we know for a fact that we know came from God is Jesus. Amen. He was born of a virgin. He came from God. He died on the cross for our sins, fully God and fully man, the Creator. And he purchased something on the cross that is beyond anything anybody anywhere could ever purchase, and that's the payment of mankind's sins in full. Now, whosoever will may come and drink of that water of life freely. That's our message. The message isn't a miracle. The message is Jesus. And any miracle that points to Jesus is from Jesus, and any miracle that leads you away from Jesus is from Satan. So this power didn't make them born again because the Holy Spirit was not yet given. They preach repentance in verse 12. We'll get there. Verse 8, and he commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey save a staff only, no scrip, no bread, no money in their purse, but be shod with sandals and put on two coats. So he's saying, look, this temporary ministry is to be supported by those who receive them. Don't pack extra shoes or clothes or coats, no fundraising, no thermometers. Don't like stand around for a year and try to raise money. If God sends you, go. We'll take care of you is the idea. Amen. So take what you have, travel light, and be the good motto for every one of us. Amen? It's like people that have children and they say, well, we're going to wait like 10 years until we have enough money for a kid. And I'm like, psh, you're going to be waiting forever. You never have enough money for a kid. You don't know that until you have a kid. So just have a kid. You'll find out like the rest of us. We make it up as we go along. And nobody would ever have any kids. You know, just do it. You know, you got to trust God with it a little bit. I mean, they're a little human. So basically travel light. Be dependent upon God. It's a good rule for all of us. If the preacher can't trust God, then how can he tell everybody else to? So we're in the Lord's army. You're his worker. People will be blessed and they'll provide. Where God guides, he provides. So travel light. We're just passing through is the idea. Verse 10. He said unto them, in whatsoever, what place soever you enter, whatever house you go into and they receive you, you there abide till you depart from that place. You don't run around looking for an upgrade or better accommodations. You be satisfied where you are. You know, where you wind up. Don't always be looking for that upgrade. You know, you go into somebody's house and they got like vegetables and stuff and the food's okay, but the guy next door says, hey, come to my house, and he's got a big steak barbecue going. You're like, I'll take my bag and go over there. They got a better room. You don't do that. Many people in ministry are doing that. They're running around looking for the perfect job. It's not about your comfort. You're in a battle. You're a warrior. Many people go from church to church like consumers looking for the perfect church. If you find it, don't join it because you ruin it, okay? That's all I can tell you. That's not ministry. It's not ministry. People look at churches, they're like, oh, ministry is not, it's being other consumed, not self-consumed. We don't run around like consumers. The one thing that I wanted from a church, the music's great and all that. If they preach the word in the church, I'll sit down and listen. If they don't preach the word of church, I'll find a church that does. It's as simple as that. It's not hard. And find people that love one another. There's going to be issues in every church. No church is perfect. Until we get to heaven, and they're the perfect church, we'll all be there. Hopefully everyone in here will be at that assembly. So I think the church has to flip its mindset in America. Church folks and pastors especially preach the word to be blessed and prosper. Happy, 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 happy all the time. We're supposed to be blessed. Comfort. My ego needs to be stroked. You need to give me a ministry. No hardship. The best accommodations. Well, Paul tells Timothy this, and I got to tell you too. We're in a battle, folks, and we're pleasing the one who chose us to be soldiers, right? So I want to work a job so that I'm not a wimp. I want to get to heaven. I don't want to be like Pee Wee Herman, you know, standing there, and all these mighty men of God, they're like, get back there, you scrub. You little wimp. God had to give you, you know, the easiest job, you know. You're looking for something. He says this to Timothy, his protege, his comrade in arm, the one who he's going to give the ministry to after his head gets chopped off. He says, and the things that thou hast heard of me, Paul's saying, the things that I said when I taught in front of many witnesses, the same things I taught you commit to faithful men. Doesn't say you have to be the smartest man in the room. Doesn't say you have to have a degree. It says you have to be faithful. The servant of the Lord must first be found faithful. You got to show up, right? People tell it all the time. You want to learn a new skill? What do they say? Show up. If you don't show up, I can't teach you. You know what I mean? So if this person is going to be faithful to show up and teach, whether there's 1, 2, 5, 10, or 15, then he's going to be faithful with the things that are committed to him, and he's going to continue to do it the rest of his life. He can't not do it. Because he's not trying to please people. He's trying to please the one that called him to do it. Who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth, you go to the front lines, you're entangling himself with the affairs of this life. Did you ever see a guy in a foxhole looking at his 401k? I don't think so. He's trying to live, to survive, and to fight, that he may please him who chose him to be a soldier. So the church needs to wake up, man. You know, we're in a war, man. Look at what's going on, even in this area. Does it trouble you that people are dying each weekend of heroin overdoses? Does that bother you? It bothers me. Does it bother you that your friends and loved ones are basically, if they don't believe in Jesus Christ, and we'll talk about that in a minute, they're not going to heaven? Does it bother you? Do you have enough chutzpah to tell them what sin is so that they can be saved? Or are you embarrassed? Or do you want to like shy away from it? Are you a soldier? Or are you, I don't know, a fan or a soldier? I'm a fan. You know, I watch football. Can't play. They won't let me. But you sit there, you watch, and you know everything. Get in the game. Get in the game. Get in the war. There's a war out there. God wants to enlist you. Imagine if every one of us enlisted today and we said, we're going to go win one soul this week for Jesus Christ. And that's all we did. We didn't go to work. We didn't eat. We didn't sleep until we won one soul to Jesus Christ. And we brought him here next week. Guess what? We'd have a parking lot problem and a seat problem. I think God, you know what God would do? He'd probably blow out that back wall and we'd be sitting in the field. He wouldn't care. So bloom where you're planted, man. You know, it reminds me of the Titanic going down and the people playing the violin, and we're all running from church to church looking for the nicest violinist. You know what I mean? And we're not showing anybody where the boats are, you know what I mean, to get off the Titanic, man. So bloom where you're planted. Don't run around from place to place, man. God's given you where you're at, and do the job there. Verse 11, and whosoever shall not receive you nor hear you when you depart from there, you shake off the dust under your feet for a testimony against them. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. So, and everybody remember Sodom and Gomorrah, right? Well, Sodom and Gomorrah's sin was not just aberrant sexual behavior. It says it was the fullness of bread and the idleness of time. That was the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. They had all the time in the world to invent real bad sin. And that's kind of where we're at in America, too. But what God did was he judged that those two cities, the cities of the plain, and he rained down fire. And now you can see from satellites, he cracked one quarter of the earth's circumference about right there in that area. And he's saying, look, if you've been all around Jesus and somebody gives you the message of Jesus and you don't want to hear it, it's going to be more tolerable for the cities that God rained down fire on than it's going to be for you that sat in a church each week and never, ever committed to Jesus Christ. They were to go into homes and tell them, the Messiah is here. His kingdom is available. Prepare to receive him. Signs and miracles followed, authenticating their message. If someone doesn't receive you, you shake the dust off your feet. And that's exactly what the Jews would do to the Gentiles. When they went through their area, they shake the dust off their feet because they're not part of the covenant people. So what he's saying to the Jews is, if you don't receive my messengers, you're not part of my covenant people. And we're shaking the dust off our feet. We could do the same thing you could do. Jesus is saying their Jewish heritage ain't going to save them. They need to accept him. So their blood is on their own heads. They become like Gentiles. So it's going to be more tolerable for them, for Sodom and Gomorrah, than for them on the day of judgment. Now, two signs of an unbeliever. They won't receive God's ministers, and they won't care for them, and they won't listen to the word of God. First of all, how do you tell God's minister? Because even Satan has angels, ministers, angels like. First of all, the word of God. Don't believe me, be a Berean, read the word of God. So if I get up here one day and I start talking crazy talk, you'll know enough. That's why I go through the Bible verse. If I get nutty, you'll kick me out. You'll know. Basically, I'm trying to teach you to put myself out of a job so you're all able ministers. So when you find a minister that's willing to preach the word of God, to support that minister or support those folks that want to give the gospel. So everybody's accountable for the light they receive, and these folks saw incredible miracles, saw God in the flesh, heard the message, and to see all that and reject Jesus is worse than Sodom and Gomorrah. There's going to be a day of judgment for all those who do not receive the message of the king. Let me tell you something. The message of the king, it's good news. It's not bad news. The bad news is everybody on this planet is sold under the slavery of Satan, okay? When you're born into sin, conceived in iniquity. Jesus Christ came to set us free from the power of darkness and translate us from this kingdom of darkness into his kingdom of light. That was his purpose, why he came, to destroy the works of the devil, to bind the strong man and you're his goods, and to come in and steal his goods and take them to be with him forever. That was his job. That's what he does. So it's good news that we're talking about here. We can have peace with God. God died on our behalf in Jesus Christ, a sacrifice that only he could pay for a debt that we owed that we could never pay. The just for the unjust, the righteous for the unrighteous. He gives us his righteousness, takes away all of our sin, and declares us righteous on his behalf. That's good news. If you don't surrender to that, here's the terms of peace. You got to surrender to Jesus, or you'll never have any peace. That's the terms. That's where the judgment comes in. If you don't want to surrender to Jesus, then all you have is an expectation of fearful judgment and the wrath of God falling on top of you. Because the wrath of God fell on Jesus, so it doesn't have to fall on you. There's a day of judgment. Zephaniah says this, 1:14, there's a day of judgment coming for the whole world. The great day of the Lord is near. It is near and hasteth greatly. Even the voice of the day of the Lord, the mighty man shall cry there bitterly. A strong man is going to weep like a baby. Verse 8, Zephaniah 2, therefore wait ye upon me, saith the Lord, until the day that I rise up to the prey. That's like a rabbit, that's a prey. For my determination is to gather the nations, that I may assemble the kingdoms, to pour upon them mine indignation, even all my fierce anger, for all the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy. At the end of the millennium, the great white throne judgment, everybody's going to come before the Lord. I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which was the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the book according to their works. Anybody want to be judged by their works? Oh, I don't want no part of that. Jesus came to deliver us from the wrath to come. He came to set us free from the darkness that is in this world. He came to set up another government, a government to which there will be no end. There won't be any Illuminati. There won't be any of this crazy nonsense going on, because Jesus Christ is going to rule and reign forever, and there will be peace and righteousness, and no one will harm anybody in all his holy mount, the Bible says. Can't wait for that day. But if you refuse the king and you refuse his terms of peace, guess what? It'd be better that, it'd be better for Sodom and Gomorrah than for you guys. That's scary. What you do with Jesus determines your eternal destiny. Verse 12, and they went out and preached. So you got to go. You can listen to the call and never go. They go. And they preached. And their preaching was so good, men started to repent. It says that men should repent. That's not quite all their message, but their message resulted in people repenting. So they went out. You got to go. You got to be a doer of the word. They preached. They heralded. They proclaimed. Their preaching was so powerful, it caused people to repent. So when the apostles proclaimed the message, they went forth to herald the king. Jesus Christ has come, the one that we waited for from Genesis 3, the one that would put his head, crush the head of the serpent and set mankind free and set us back. God would put us on his lap one day and we would wipe away every tear from our eye. That's Jesus. That's the one that would come. He's the guy that you need to go after. There's no salvation in any other but him. He's the one that came to set you free from all of your habits, your addictions, your trouble, all your mental problems. Jesus Christ can set you free from all of them. He came to set the captives free, bind up the brokenhearted, and proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Amen. And that's why he came. So when that preaching came, people were like, oh my goodness, I better get right with God. And they started to repent. Now, what does repentance mean? So they didn't create this message. They brought the message. The message was already given to them by Jesus. And that message should bring about repentance. What is repentance? It's kind of a lost thing. We think of about it, a guy like saying, repent, you go to hell. That's not what it is. Repentance is the word metanoia. It simply means to change your mind. Do a 180. You've been thinking this way, and you need to change your mind and start thinking this way. You need to do a 180. You need to stop listening to the world and the psychiatrists and all the people that have this world's opinion, and you need to start looking at heavenly opinion. You need to start thinking of what God says, of what the Bible says about eternity, about heaven, and about hell. You need to start thinking about judgment to come. You need to start thinking about those things. And if you do change your mind, you're going to start repenting. You're going to change your lifestyle too. It's realizing your depravity, your need for a Savior. Pews are filled with unrepentant sinners. Pews are filled with many in churches won't even tell you what sin is because it might offend people. Well, you know what? Sin, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. Sin is missing the mark. We've all sinned. Sin is what put Jesus on the cross so he could pay for our sins. So if you can't define sin, how do you know you need a Savior? Repentance is doing a 180. It's changing your lifestyle. God is not willing, the Bible says, that any perish but all should come to what? Repentance, change their mind. It's recognizing sin, agreeing with God about it, turning from it, and asking for forgiveness. Now, I got to tell you, it's not perfection. We're never going to be perfect in these bodies. I sin, you sin, we all sin. But I'm not what I used to be. I ain't participating in the lifestyle I used to participate in. There should be. Now, can someone be saved without repentance? People will ask. What does the Bible say? Let me read it for you. God has commanded all men everywhere to what? Repent. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. Jesus would say, except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. The church of Thyatira, a whole church system, Jesus tells the whole church system, if you don't repent, I'm going to cast you into great tribulation. So somehow the modern day church has so-called converts who believe in a mental assent of Jesus, but they don't know Jesus. There's no power in their life. They still live in their sins, unconfessed, unforsaken. And if you mention it, you know, it might hurt their feelings. Well, I hope your feelings are hurt so you'll turn to Jesus and he can make you whole again. I didn't invent this message. I realize I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. Jesus is the only figure in human history that offers salvation. Buddha does it. Muhammad does it. None of them do it. Jesus is the only one. To hear the message of Jesus should cause us to repent. Now, the law brings what? A knowledge of sin, correct? Let's do a little study here before we leave. Has anybody ever told a lie? You're all a bunch of liars, admit it. I lied. I was great at it as a child. Has anybody ever stole anything? Or cheated on a tax, anything small? Or cheated on bowling scores? Or Yahtzee? I know you have Yahtzee. Don't tell me you have my grandma. She's the holiest woman ever, and she cheated on that game all the time. Every time I turn around, there's something flipped over. She's got Yahtzee. I'm like, nobody gets four Yahtzees in a game, grandma. So you're liars and you're cheaters. Okay, has anybody ever looked, your whole life, ever looked on a man or a woman and said, they're hot and I would like to date them? Yeah, there's some holy people saying, no, I never did that. You need to confess. So by your own admission, you're a bunch of lying, thieving, adulterers at heart, right? Seriously, think about that. And if you were to meet God, you would go where? You would deserve to, too, right? I would, too, because I've done those things, thought, word, or deed, right? So the law brings a knowledge of sin so that we can meet Jesus Christ and we can know that our sins can be washed away. It's a schoolmaster. And when that message is given to a human heart or a human soul, it changes your life. Changes your lifestyle. I don't want to participate in unrighteousness. I want to participate in righteousness now. So I fight against. Now I'm at war. I just became a soldier. Who am I at war with? Me. I'm at war with my own flesh. That's my problem. And the Bible even calls it. He says, the spirit wars against the flesh and the flesh wars against the spirit. So you're at this, like, I mean, as soon as you get saved, you're schizophrenic. And you're going to be that way until you awaken in his likeness and this body of flesh is gone and you no longer have those temptations anymore. But when you meet Jesus Christ, he imparts his spirit in you and that spirit causes you to leave your old lifestyle. I never needed a Bible study to tell me smoking pot was wrong. I never needed a Bible study to tell me to lust is wrong. I already knew that the day I was saved. And I already knew Jesus wanted to move me away from that and move me into his kingdom of light. I'm no longer a child of darkness. I am set free and you should be set free. And that message should cause other people to repent. And when they come to church, it's filled with a bunch of people that don't do that. What do they say? You guys are a bunch of hypocrites. How am I going to believe your message? You can't even live right. I'm talking about just the basics. We should not divorce our wives. We should live holy lives as best as we can. And we should be quick to ask people to forgive us when we do wrong. And that's how we should live as believers. Coming into contact with Jesus and his good news will cause folks to repent and change their mind and turn from sin, not accommodate it. And I think that's what we're doing. We're accommodating sin. When we get to heaven, Jesus, I got to talk to the pastor. He's going to say, you better preach what I say. I'm going to be accountable for it. Verse 13, and we'll close. And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them. So I can't help but the step of faith that they had when Jesus gave them power. He said, now go out and do what I do. And the first person that came up to them to be healed, I would be wondering if it's going to work or not. You know what I mean? Like, okay, be healed. It works, you know what I mean? Imagine if you had that power. I would go to Lehigh Valley Hospital and just be like, you're healed, you're healed, you're healed, you're healed, you're all the way down the line. I would love it. ICU would be empty. They would all be happy running and jumping and playing. Everybody would be happy. Nobody would be crying. There would be no need of a chapel there or some phony minister to walk around in rooms because Jesus healed them all.
That's right.
That'd be great. Go to the prison and they're all walking out happy, like behaving. Man. So the results of the ministry were evident. Many were delivered. So authentic that Herod hears about it. We're talking about him next week. So I believe that if the church would repent and preach the gospel in such a way that people would understand what they've been delivered from and how Christ paid for our sin, if we humbled ourselves and prayed and asked the Lord to touch people, sought his face, and asked the Lord to revive our own hearts and to live what we believe, I think that that would set on fire many people and God would use us in a mighty way. So make that decision today. The good news is still going out. It's still good news. Judgment hasn't come yet. Accept Jesus. Join his army. We're in an army. And we can do damage, amen? Do damage against the enemy. And we can set people free. Eternal benefits outweigh the temporary hardships. I'm sure you agree. Let's stand. We'll pray. And we'll ask Jesus to fill us and give us that unction that we need so desperately in these last days. Father God, Lord, I thank you for your love towards us. I thank you for the grace that we all enjoy. Lord, we realize, Lord, that there is a judgment coming and you don't want anybody to perish, but all to come to repentance, to change their mind about who you are. That you're our Savior, you died on the cross for our sins, and you're also our Lord. You're the captain of the Lord's army. You're mighty. And Lord, we want to be used by you. Lord, we're tired of seeing our friends and loved ones taken captive by the enemy. And we ask that you give us the unction and the power. And give us the words to say, Lord. Give us the lives that are lived in such a way that attract people to who you are. Help us, Lord, to love like you loved us, Lord. So we give you our lives afresh. We ask to be filled with your Spirit. Use us, Lord. Use every man and woman in this room in these last days, wherever they are, whatever situation they find themselves in, Lord, that you would grow them right there, Lord, and they do mighty works for you, I pray, in your name.